All right, good morning, everyone. Welcome this morning. As you find your seat, I will open us in a passage of scripture. It says in Psalm 119, "You have dealt well with your servant, O Lord, according to your word. Teach me good judgment and knowledge, for I believe in your commandments. Before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I keep your word. You are good and do good. Teach me your statutes. The insolent smear me with lies, but with my whole heart I keep your precepts. Their heart is unfeeling like fat, but I delight in your law. It is good for me that I was afflicted, that I might learn your statutes. The law of your mouth is better to me than thousands of gold and silver pieces." Let me pray. Father, thank you this morning for gathering your church together. I pray that as we prepare for worship, that we will limit our distractions and limit the things that pop into our minds, and help us to focus in on these statutes, these commands, this book of the law, the word of God that you have given us here this morning to open and treasure and cherish and be confronted by, but also to see where you have some points for us to learn and grow and build upon and persevere in this Christian life. And I pray now that all we do will honor the name of Jesus. In your name I pray. Amen. Stand with me, if you will, as we sing our opening song. The Lord's Prayer together this morning. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. You may be seated. Let's see. A couple announcements this morning. Catechism, kids, class, after the service this morning, adult Bible study, after the service as well, and our youth group at 5 o'clock tonight. We had a good group tonight. Invite your friends if you came, and keep inviting. It was a good time. I'm excited about it. I really am, and I think Bailey and Dylan and Christina are all very excited as well about the potential and what I'm hearing from other teens. So that's a good thing. We're walking through some of the key foundational steps to what is being a Christian all about. What is the Christian worldview? And we're walking through and beginning to take a step in that range, because this is, as you know, a key time in their lives to build those foundational truths and principles into their minds. So that's what we're doing. Any other announcements before birthdays and all that? Announcements? Yes. Yes.
We had a card for our pastor for his birthday. And thank you very much for everything you do.
Thank you all. I do. Yeah. Christina says it's my week to my face to turn red. So, birthdays. There's others this week. Kenzie has a birthday. Fred has a birthday. Diane, I saw you back there slip in. Yes, Diane has a birthday. Randy had a birthday. If you see these people, please tell them happy birthday this week. But I guess you can sing to me and Diane this morning. I'll sing to you. You can sing to me. How's that? Happy birthday. Birthday, Diane. Anniversaries, you see Daryl and Jennifer Kibler. Please tell them happy anniversary this week. Are there any prayer requests, any praises, anything going on, any updates? Mary did tell me that Cross Drake is doing fine. It was some kind of infection, and he's doing a lot better. So that's a huge answer to prayer. Knox, do you have a very important announcement? You have to say it real, real loud. That is a cool shirt. I like dinosaurs. You ready? Mm-hmm. Go ahead. Say it real loud. What's your announcement?
There's a baby in my mama.
There's a baby in your mama. Good job. Yes. Dylan and Bailey are expecting their second child. They're very excited. We are too. We're looking at. Yes. That's okay. Yeah. Yeah. And we're looking at April 25th. So, yeah. So pray for her. Pray for Knox. It's going to be a new step for him too, and Dylan as well. And we're excited for you guys. Very excited. Yeah. What? Anything else this morning? That's good news. Yeah. Yeah, hopefully it keeps going. Yeah. Clay hopes so too. Or not. Yeah, Sam.
Right.
Friday. Yeah. Yeah. It's encouraging news, though. Yeah. Anything else this morning? Any updates? October 3rd. Yes. There is going to be a meal. I'm sure Christina will say something about that if you want to help with that next week. Just going to be for kind of immediate family. There's going to be a visitation. I need to look at the. They haven't gotten with me yet, so we still have to work out a few things. Cheryl had her bypass, and she was recovering from that, double bypass. Heather was recovering from that, and, you know, there's just a lot of things that they're trying to figure out what they want to do as they come back. October 3rd, yes. That's 11. Yeah. Food's a huge draw. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, and I should have said, we meet from 5 to 6, so it's not, you know, a long portion of the night, it's just an hour, but, you know, we've got some things I think the kids want to do, so it could be a fun fall once things, you know, settle down a little bit, maybe some bonfires or whatever, so we're excited about where this can go and where it can lead for the kids in this community, teens in this community. So any other prayer requests, praises? No? Okay. Let me pray for these this morning. Heavenly Father, I come before you this morning once again asking you to hear our corporate prayer time. I am thankful for this time that we can gather around and share what's going on in our lives, the good news, the hard news, the bad news, whatever it is. We can share these things and we know and find comfort in the fact that others are praying for us and for others. Father, I thank you this morning for Dylan and Bailey's good news, expecting another child. I pray that things will go smoothly for them and for her as she fights the morning sickness and all those things that come along with a kid. And I just pray that you will give her grace during those moments and that things will proceed smoothly. And that we'll get to see that new baby in 2021. And we're grateful and thankful this morning for your hand of blessing in their lives. And Father, I thank you that things have gone so well at the school so far this year. There's been a few cases of this virus going, but overall, things have gone pretty smoothly. And we're grateful for the teachers and the leaders that took it so seriously to provide a good experience for the kids to get back in school and continue their education and learning and all those things that go along with that. And we pray for your grace as they continue. Father, I thank you that Glenn seems to be progressing and that he may get to come home Friday. I pray that that's one step of the journey to another. And Father, it's going to be a long road, and we pray for strength for him. And just ask for your grace to Cindy as well as she helps him, and that, Lord, you'll give them wisdom and the grace they need and the strength they need to keep pushing on and to get well and get some things back to a little sense of normal. Lord, we thank you that Cross is doing well and that it was just an infection and that little baby is doing better. And Lord, I thank you for all the teens that came last week to our new youth group. And I just pray that you will continue to grow this, that it can have a huge benefit to our community. And anytime, Father, that we get to speak the truths of the Bible, speak the truths of Jesus into someone's life, it is a good thing. And we pray that you will continue to grow this and that lives will be transformed by the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we are just completely grateful for how you continue to work in lives. Even sometimes I know that we feel like things could be better, things could go smoother, but it's in those moments that even then you are transforming us. You are sanctifying us in those moments to put our trust and our faith in you. And Father, this morning, I continue to ask that you will do just that because you are truly a faithful God. Focus our minds now. Help us to focus on your word and what it has for your church. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right, open your Bibles with me this morning to Matthew 18. We're continuing our series on the church this morning. Matthew 18, first book in the New Testament, a couple chapters in. We have been looking at different aspects of what a church should be about, what they should be committed to, those steps of the apostles' teaching, the breaking of bread, communion last week. And now, those are major theological topics, themes, and this week we're going to dive into something much more practical, everyday, applicable to your lives and to my life as well. And it's an interesting passage that we find where Jesus is teaching his disciples an important story, not just a story, but an important lesson about what it's like to handle conflict. Now, you know, we all experience conflict in this life, and it can be in the church, it can be outside the church. It's not new to us that we experience issues. Even this morning, the kids, I heard some conflicting arguments happening and mom stepping in and handling it. And it reminded me of a story, you may remember it a few years ago. It seems like a few years ago, but 1992, you remember the lady Stella who burnt herself with a cup of coffee. If you remember, McDonald's ended up paying her $2.9 million because the coffee was hot and she spilled it on herself. If you can imagine, it seems ridiculous, but is there a better way to handle conflicts than having to sue everybody all the time? I don't know if you can think about it with me, but I get tired of hearing all the lawsuits and all these things that happen over and over again. Some are justifiable. So some, we think about the church or a family or a people that God has chosen to represent him. Is there a better way to handle issues that arise among us? And I believe there is. In Matthew 18, it gives us the process to handle these things. You see, I say often, the Bible, when Jesus saves us, he doesn't just leave us there. He doesn't just say, go ahead and do what you need, figure it out. No, he gives us the manual, the guidelines, the principles for how to live the godly life he desires of us. And here, he's giving us the way to handle conflict amongst ourselves. So my goal this morning is to show that unrepentant sin, unrepentant conflict must be dealt with for the health of the church. So let's dive in. Matthew 18. Our first point this morning, unrepentant conflict should be dealt with privately. Matthew 18, 15. If your brother or sister sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you have gained your brother or sister. So, we're diving in. We know, as we look at this, that Matthew says, if your brother or sister sins against you, it's no secret. Conflict is going to happen. We are sinful human beings. We have different opinions. We have different cultural backgrounds in one sense or another, and we're going to have differences on topics. Now, I must say, this is different than having differences, right? conflict is bigger than just having differences with somebody. So I think it would be important this morning to dive into this theme of what is conflict? What do I mean by that? How do we deal with that? How do we not deal with it? How do we sometimes deal with it in an ungodly way? And then what does Scripture tell us to do? So first, what is conflict? What is it? Well, it's when we have a disagreement. Maybe it's verbal, maybe it's physical, and it escalates to the point where maybe a fight breaks out. Now, in the Latin, it actually means to strike someone, but it doesn't have to always include that. Conflict is a common military term, as you know as well, where two people are at odds with one another and something has happened and sin has occurred. And the issue is that it has not been made right. Now, what does God think about this conflict? These issues that arise between two people, and in particular, this passage refers to Christians, the church. What does God think? Well, God doesn't have a high view of conflict. God does not like it. God wants his children to pursue peace with one another. Ephesians 4, 1 through 3. I therefore, a prisoner of the Lord, Paul's talking, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. God wants us to pursue peace with one another. Next, God wants his children to glorify him. 1 Corinthians 10:31. So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. God wants us to glorify him in every instance in life. God wants his children to not sin against one another. Matthew 5, 44 through 45. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and on the unjust. God wants us to get along with one another. He does not like when conflicts happen. God wants his children to communicate in a biblical way, in an uplifting, encouraging way. And we'll deal more with that in just a moment. But where did these conflicts come? We see and we look on the news or wherever it may be, and we see these bad things happening, and we wonder, why is this happening? Why are people doing this? And if you think about Genesis 3 or Romans 3, we're not going to turn there this morning, but you probably know enough to know that sin has infected all of us. These things happen because we are sinners. And it's not easy to get past the pride, the sinful pride that we all struggle with, the sinful thoughts we all struggle with. Think back to Cain and Abel. It started even in the beginning. This sinful pride, these sinful thoughts that led to the first murder. We see these things happening and we wonder, God, why? Well, here are some thoughts that may lead to conflict when we are in the battle with one another. Well, sometimes we say, that's ridiculous. Why could that person ever think that way? You know, sometimes, and you may say a version of this in your head, I'm guilty as well, I will have my way or no way. Sometimes we say, how dare they do that? How dare they say that to me? Sometimes I will say, I will not be treated this way. Right? We've all said something to that extent. And these things, these thoughts lead to conflict. Instead, there is a better way. Instead, maybe we should say, maybe they have a point, right? I don't know everything. Maybe they have a point. I don't have to have my way. Sometimes someone else's way is better. Sometimes we need to step back and say, maybe instead of defending myself, maybe I just need to pray for this person. And sometimes we need to ask ourselves, how can I return good to these people, just like the text told us? Now, can differences, can disagreements be beneficial? And I believe the answer is yes. They can be beneficial because sometimes in the midst of that disagreement, we realize, well, maybe I had it wrong. Maybe I was wrong about this situation. But that doesn't mean conflict has to happen. You do not have to sin because you have differences with someone else. And that is hard. I get it. It's very hard to not let conflict arise in our hearts. And how do we handle these situations then? Well, let's start with some sinful ways to avoid conflict. These are ways that you don't want to do that just lead to more sin, more bitterness. Sometimes just keeping quiet doesn't solve anything. It only makes matters worse when we don't confront or tell the person that something wrong has happened. Sometimes we stay away from the person. What does that solve? Nothing. Sometimes we just change the subject and we never deal with it. And sometimes we just hide the information, we hide the sins, we hide the bitterness that has grown in our hearts. And sure enough, you know what typically happens? You blow up at the person. These are ways that we try to avoid conflict, but they don't work. We know this from life's experiences. They do not work. If it's not for the other person who may not even know that something has happened, in your own heart, it tears at you. It rips you up. That bitterness, that resentment grows and festers, and at some point, it will come out. Now, here are some thoughts to avoid conflict. Right thinking. Sometimes we just need to give a gentle answer. Sometimes we just need to pursue peace in the situation. We need to seek the good of our neighbor and what is best, loving God, loving neighbor. Sometimes we need to just let love cover it. Sometimes there are situations where we can do that and we can say, it's okay, I can let God, I can let love cover. I don't need to hold on to this. There's no bitterness. I know they may have been having a bad day. Let's let it go. But then other times, we can't do that. So, what do we do? Well, as with most topics in the Bible gives us a way to resolve conflict. Confess it. Make sure your heart is right before God. Confess the sin to Him. Seek His forgiveness. Know that He will forgive you. Express a desire to that other person that it's happened to resolve the conflict between you and that person. And come together. Meet. Get together. Desire to pray together, hoping that you can resolve this and in the end be reconciled. Now, part of that probably means there's forgiveness that happens. There's an apology that happens, maybe from both people. But whatever it is, reconciliation needs to be the goal. Now, I thought it was important to cover these things as a framework for this passage because we all deal with conflict. Now, as we dive into more on Matthew 18, we must realize sin is going to happen. Conflicts are going to happen. Repentance, reconciliation, forgiveness are always the goals. Those are the goals when we desire to look through this passage and see the process that God has given the church for dealing with things that happen in our lives. It's a three-step process, but remember, reconciliation is always the goal. When I say that, I mean making things right between you and that other person is always the goal. You must have that as your central focus. So let's dive in. First, look back at verse 15. It says to deal with the sin privately, right? Between you and the brother. Now, why would you want to do that? Well, A, it limits gossip, right? Maybe something's happened between you and someone else. Maybe it's between Christina and I, or let's say Perry and I. I'll pick on someone, I don't know. Whatever it may be. But no one else needs to know what's happened. Now, why would you go to that person and talk to them? Well, the goal would be to make it right. Well, how can I make this thing right between you and I? Because we are not in good standing, and I can't love my neighbor if there is conflict or unresolved sin between us. I must do that. Now, another reason might be that I go to the person and I realize I had a complete misunderstanding. And then we just need to say, okay, love can cover this. Let's move on. Let's be reconciled. I misunderstood what was happening, and we can keep going. It's like the kids have been on an Andy Griffith Show kick lately, and we've been watching. And there's this one episode, you may remember, where there's two families. They're at odds with one another. And there's a young couple comes into Andy, wants to get married, and sure enough, there's two fathers that end up coming in with guns pointing at each other, and they don't want them to get married. So Andy goes out, and you know, Andy, his thing, he's trying to wrestle through and figure out how to resolve it so there's no big ordeal or no one gets shot or anything like that. So he goes out, and he talks to one father. He said, well, why are you fighting with this person? And he doesn't know why. Well, he goes and talks to the other father, and sure enough, he doesn't know why they're fighting. And sure enough, by the end, they come together, and they're lifelong friends because they've been fighting for so long. They know each other so well. And sometimes, I think, we're seeking to deal with these issues, the conflicts that come between us. We need to get on the same page. We can't just let things go because it doesn't end well. It will not end well for either party. Now, much could be avoided if we just practice good communication. So let's take a few moments and look at that. If you have your Bible there, look at Ephesians 4, they'll be on the screen as well, but write the verse down because it's an important little passage for us to remember what good communication looks like. These are principles we have applied in our own lives, and we've tried to instill them or starting to instill them in our kids' lives. But here are four from Ephesians and one from James, principles for good communication. First, be honest. Ephesians 4 and verse 25 says, therefore, having put away falsehood, lying, let each one of you speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. Truth is of utmost importance when we communicate. We know this. Lying doesn't help anything. Second point, keep current. Continuing in Ephesians, be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger and give no opportunity to the devil. Meaning, we don't let it fester in our minds. We deal with it. We have to deal with the conflict that arises between us or issues that rise between us. Third, attack the problem and not people. When we use our voices, and there's plenty of proverbs to talk here, to attack people, it will not end well. You know this. Someone gets in your face and starts screaming at you or attacking you or pointing out all the things you've done wrong, you don't typically respond very well, right? Well, if we attack problems and not people, solutions can be made. Continuing in Ephesians, let the thief no longer steal, but rather let him labor, doing honest work with his own hands so that he may have something to share with anyone in need. Let no corrupting talk come out of your mouths, but only such as good for building up as fits the occasion, that it may give grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. See, we must attack the problems and not people. We must change how we think about that. Fourth, act, don't react. Again, solutions-oriented, reconciliation-oriented themes here. Continuing in Ephesians, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, along with all malice. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ forgave you. And then last, you can write down James 1, 19 through 20. Listen attentively. So many times I have put my foot in my mouth because I did not listen attentively. I did not listen. James 1, 19 says, know this, my beloved brothers. Let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger, for the anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God. The five general principles for better communication, good, solid, biblical communication that will help us avoid the conflicts that can arise in our lives. But remember, first one is deal with it between you and the person. Now, we're going to move on. Go back to Matthew 18. Look at verses 16 through 17. Unrepentant conflict should be dealt with corporately, not just privately, but now corporately. And you'll see what I mean by that in just a moment. Verse 16. But if he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, that every charge may be established by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if he refuses to listen even to the church, let him be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. So the process continues. If there's no reconciliation, if you can't deal with it, just you and the other person, what's the text say? Take others with you. Now, it says two or three witnesses, meaning take one or two. And this is more a historical understanding of this passage to understand why this is so important. But in Deuteronomy 19, in the Old Testament, it was taught that the Jews would take up to 10 people with them to establish on the evidence of if someone was guilty or not. So the writer here, Jesus, is also pulling from that and letting them know that, you know, you don't have to do that any longer. You can take just one or two people with you. But the point being, you must take these to encourage reconciliation, encourage forgiveness, encourage that the conflict might be dealt with. And if it's not, we move to step three. We must take it to the church. You see, God has let his church have spiritual authority to deal with spiritual matters. Remember, this isn't something that's going to be dealt with necessarily overnight. Some, it takes a while for there to be reconciliation. Now, you want it to be speedy. You want it to happen fast, but that's not always the case. And that is why when it happens between Christians, confessing Christians, Jesus says, take it to the church. But notice, the church must be a place where disagreements are allowed, where differences are allowed, so that a resolution can be made in a healthy way. We must be a church that strives for forgiveness and reconciliation. Now, when the church gets involved, its goal is not to belittle. Its goal is not to punish the person. Even in our text, we'll see here in a few moments that this is truly a spiritual matter. But the text says, you shall refer to them as a Gentile or a tax collector. Well, those were two derogatory terms that Jesus would have been using in this passage. Let's move on. Look at verses 18 through 20. Unrepentant conflict should be dealt with spiritually. 18 through 20, it says, truly I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again, I say to you, if two of you agree on earth about anything they ask, it will be done for them by the Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, there am I among them. Unrepentant sin is a spiritual matter. Unrepentant conflict is a spiritual matter. Remember, the text said, whatever you bind or loose on earth shall be bound or loosed in heaven. Christ gave the church the authority to act on these spiritual matters. The process we've learned is to deal with unrepentant sin. See, that's the point. It's ongoing, unrepentant sin between two people that has not been resolved. And we find here a process for how to do it. Now, we deal with a difficult passage here. Verse 20, for where two or three are gathered in my name, there am I among them. Now, this passage has been used very wrong many, many times. There's been many misconceptions on how to apply this, but remember, context is key when we read any passage of Scripture. And here we find the context is discipline, is reconciliation between two people. And we must remember that as we see here. And don't forget that Jesus affirms that those who are present are able to act in this spiritual case, this spiritual matter, this unresolved conflict between two people. And remember this. As we deal with these things, we ask God to forgive us when we sin and know that, 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. See, the point is this. As Christians, when we fully realize the forgiveness, the fact that we can be reconciled to God now through Jesus, we realize that we can forgive others as well. We realize that there's no sin too great that we can't forgive someone else. There's no sin too great that we should hold on to it and become bitter and resentful and not like that fellow brother and sister in Christ. No, we need to be reconciled because God has made that possible for us in Him. Deal with it privately, if possible. If not, take someone along with you. Encourage this person to repent. Be open-minded through the process that maybe you've misunderstood what is going on. Then third and last, get the church involved, especially if it's a fellow brother and sister in Christ, because we are here to help you, guide you through that process. Now, remember, if they won't reconcile, continue to seek reconciliation and forgiveness. If they do, it's over. We're done. We're moving on. We're applying those biblical principles of forgiveness. If they say, man, I was wrong to do that, will you forgive me? This process is over. Now we use wisdom in how we go forward, but we're reconciled. And we don't bring it up again. We move past this problem and we can be like a family once more. I read this week. This person said, the kingdom of heaven is a place where sinners are mercifully restored and where people are quick to forgive and to seek reconciliation, knowing that God in His grace has forgiven them. Let us pray. Father, thank You this morning that Your Word gives us answers to life, truth for life. That's we know as sinners that we are going to have problems with one another. We know conflicts are going to arise. We've experienced them in the past, and we've seen the hurt and the shame and the guilt that comes with not dealing with these in a godly way. But I'm thankful this morning that we have the answer. We have an example of how to deal with it in a biblical, Christ-honoring fashion. Father, I pray this morning that we will commit to resolving, to dealing with these conflicts that arise among us. And Father, most of all, I pray that in general, we will just practice these good communication tips from Ephesians and James that You have given us to how to avoid such issues. Help us to persevere in applying them to our daily conversations and in daily life. And most of all, I pray that You will be glorified in the process. Help us to love You more and love our neighbors more. In Your name I pray. Amen. As you gather your communion cup, I'll read a passage for us this morning. It's from Matthew. It says, now as they were eating, Jesus took bread, and after blessing it, He broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, take, eat, this is My body. And He took a cup, and when He had given thanks, He gave it to them, saying, drink of it, all of you, for this is the blood of My covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Father, thank You this morning that we can gather and celebrate what you have accomplished for us. By giving your body and your blood for us, we might have and be reconciled to God once more. Lord, we are saddened that these sinful things happen in our lives and that we must deal with them. But I'm grateful this morning that because of Jesus, we can. And we can be made whole once more. And in your name I pray. Amen. After you finish, please stand with me so we can sing our closing song this morning. Now, this is a familiar song, but a new version of it. Christina said I should give a prerequisite to it, but I think you'll catch on pretty quickly.
Savior ever true, oh Jesus, we
Father, thank you today that we can turn our eyes off ourselves and point them to you and know that you are in complete control of all things. You are the all-sovereign God of this universe, and I pray we will hold on to that truth this week as we try to wrestle with these things. As conflicts come into our lives, help us to apply the words you have given us and trust you through the process. That you have it under control. May Jesus be big in our lives this week. In your name I pray. Amen.